Judas in heaven, raise your hand. Judas in hell, raise your hand. Y'all are, come on, a bunch of chickens. This is the safest place you can think.
A very special greeting to all of you all on this Tuesday night. Grateful to God for the opportunity to gather back together and continue in the study of God's word in a deep and a relevant way. I want to send a very special welcome to everyone, especially those gathering with us for the very first time. We don't take that for granted. If this is your first Bible study, if you don't mind, would you just wave a hand that we might identify and thank God for you? Would you help me bless God for all of our first time, the people who are with us on today? Excited and grateful for you all to join with us in our summer season as we take a break from Awana and some of our other children's programs. Usually that just gathers the adults and the serious Bible students out on Tuesday. So I want to welcome each and every one of you on tonight. Got something really deep to continue into based upon where we've been over the last few weeks. Dr. Judy and I continue to work together to create our syllabus for Bible study. And I want to today get us back into really what is one of the most relevant issues that comes from a debate we've been having. If you remember a few months ago, we began our debate about free will versus providence. You remember that? And I shared with you that this really is the beginning point of a lot of debate within Christianity, that once you begin to understand how this debate plays itself out, you'll understand some different doctrinal positions that we have in the body of Christ over some very relevant, but yet some subtle things that we may not always give heed and attention to, but some different thoughts that we debate and discuss that come out of free will versus providence. Just as a quick way of reminding what the issue is for those who have not been with us, because we are definitely not going back down this road again tonight. The debate is between how much of your life is directed and determined by your choice and how much is predetermined and preset by God. And we saw through historical debate, through our own debate, through scripture, that there is a wide spectrum from those who are on the extreme side of saying that all of life is predetermined by God, that everything you do, God has already seen, God has already known, God has already ordained. And then there are those who argue that most of life is a result of our free choice, that we make decisions that shape our lives, and that our relationship and walk with the Lord is very fluid, that God responds, reacts, and changes based upon our life and our decisions and our choices that we make. From here, I argued to you in the beginning a few weeks ago with Dr. Judy that this gets us into the next big issue of faith, soteriology. Somebody remind me what soteriology is. It's the study of what? Salvation, right? It comes from a Greek term, sozo, which means to be saved. Soteriology, just like biology is the study of life, soteriology is the study of salvation. And so what we've been doing over the past few weeks is really looking at what we mean by being saved. So we started off with some different perspectives of salvation that broaden our understanding beyond simply a personal relationship with the Lord, but how there's a justice component, how there's a communal component, that salvation, both biblical and practical, is not simply whether you keep the Ten Commandments, but rather about how we live out our lives in relation to God and in relation to one another. Soteriology. From there, Dr. Judy opened up, and I want to give her credit because she's more of a Bible teacher. She doesn't like dealing with theology as much as I do, so I want to just applaud her for getting into the next big issue, which is the exclusivity of salvation. And you all have taken time out to examine the three different perspectives on exclusivity of salvation. For those who aren't familiar with that terminology, that is the question or the issue: does salvation only exist in Jesus Christ? I.e., are Christians the only ones in a saved relationship with the Almighty God? And if you recall, there are three different traditional positions on this. There is the exclusivist, who believes that only in Jesus Christ. Those are the John 14:6 believers, Jesus, the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father but by him. There are the pluralists who believe that salvation exists in Christ and the possibility of salvation exists outside of Christianity. So those would be the ones who would argue that I believe Christians are saved, but I will also give room for the possibility that a Muslim is saved, or that a Jew is saved, or that someone who practices a different faith, that there is the possibility of salvation outside of Jesus Christ. And then, of course, there is the third one. So you've got the exclusivists, the pluralists, and then what's the one nobody really kind of bought on? That was the universalists. I heard about you all's debate on the universalists. That is the everybody's saved, everybody's going to heaven. The death of Jesus Christ is so powerful that it covers even those who don't confess in him as Lord and Savior. And you took time out to listen to, and I want to thank you for doing that, the NPR interview with Carlton Pearson. And I understand that that was challenging to some, enlightening to others, and absolutely disrespectful and unbaptist to the rest of y'all. So we're not going to listen to any more of that in this sanctuary. But I do want to thank you all for exposing yourself to a different train of thought. Remember, we come to Alpha Street and Bible State to think, right? To grow our minds, to stretch out a little bit. Well, from here, we get into really what is one of the next logical discussions in our chapter on soteriology. The exclusivity of salvation then leads to this next discussion, which we start today, and that is eternal security. What I want to endeavor to do tonight is try to get you to see how this question and how you answer it directly comes from how you answer the question of free will versus providence. Because remember, what I'm trying to do is to be certain that there is a logical coherence to how you think, so that wherever you stand on free will and providence should determine where and how you stand on eternal security. And if there's a gap between these two, I want you to be aware of it. So where you land on the spectrum between how much of my life is choice and how much is determined by God also determines how you view eternal security. And that's ultimately what I'm trying to get to tonight, all right? So that being said, I want you to turn with me to a couple passages of scripture. Let's start in the New Testament. If you would join in with me in Ephesians chapter 1. The question I want us to kind of ponder in the back of our head as we read through just a few passages, here's the question. To what degree does free will play in the salvation of humanity? To what degree is free will active and involved in the salvation of humanity? How much of salvation is a result of our choice versus a result of what the Lord has predetermined? Does everyone see that question? We get it? To what degree does free will play itself out in salvation? You're going to find that there are some differing perspectives. Let's start in Ephesians chapter 1, beginning in verse number 3, just to hear what Paul writes here in Ephesians 1, verse 3, starting off. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound toward us all in wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of the times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that he who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. In him you also trusted, after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. Amen. So as you read and hear what Paul writes in Ephesians 1, verse 3 through 14, what are you hearing about salvation? What words jumped out to you as you heard or read these verses? What words jumped out to kind of talk about how we are saved? All right, so we see predestined, right? Predestined shows up. What else? Chose, symbolizing that this was an act of God. God chose us. God predestined us. Any other words jump out? Trusted, that we trusted, okay? Now, pause right there. I'm coming back to it. Other words, inherited, chose. We inherited something. Something that was prepared for us. What'd you say, Dre? We were sealed, okay? In most of the words you just pulled out, we are the indirect object that's being acted upon. If you know grammar, right? We're chosen, we're sealed, we're predestined. The one word that comes out that puts us in the subject of the verb is what Michelle lifted, trusted, that there's an act that we've done. So the majority of what Paul writes here seems to suggest that salvation is something that we've inherited, that was predestined, that God chose us, but yet there is an element where we receive it by our trust. So there's a balance here almost, that God has chosen us, but there's something we must do to receive it, right? Do you agree on that, or is there disagreement? Okay. How many people believe that if you are saved, that's because that was God's will for your life? How many believe that? If you're saved, don't be afraid. It's Tuesday. It's not Sunday, okay? You're not going to go to hell, all right? Okay. How many of you believe that if you are saved, it's because that was God's will? Okay. Keep your hand up. So all of you believe that it was God's will if you're saved. So if you're unsaved, is that God's will? Don't put your hand, you know, no, you got your hand up now, all right? Okay, let me ask a second question. How many of you believe that to some degree, you're being saved as a result of a decision you made? How do we reconcile this? Is it choice? Is it predestined? Okay, help me reconcile. For those who are saying both, I just want to clarify because I'm slow, so I need you to help me. How do we make them both? Right? It's available, but if I don't choose it, then that's me. And that's not the will of God. So if I perish in my sins, and however you define salvation, and I wind up in hell, where however you define that, that's a choice, that's not a predetermined will. I'd like to argue, I'm sorry. Okay. How do we make them both? Free will, right? Okay, now here, and I'm gonna agree with you, but I wanna push it, because that's what I do. So if it's God's will that all be saved, but obviously all are not, how do you reconcile that? That there's an element of choice. Okay. Yep. I know we argue. Go ahead.
So the question I have then is, how do you reconcile that with when God talks about Pharaoh? I hardened his heart, and so he doesn't turn around, which means, theoretically, Pharaoh had no choice. That plus some pots are made for, clay to be broken. Right. So how do you reconcile that?
First of all, it's a very good question and insight. Because we see, especially in that example, that Pharaoh's heart is hardened almost as if God has determined you will not be saved, right? Okay. Now, just so you know, the scholars I operate in and we're here, we're going to say that is an Old Testament dispensation before the coming of Jesus Christ, and therefore it is under a whole different set of laws and operating procedures. I'm going to come back to it in a little bit. But there are those who would argue that whenever you look at things before Christ, it's a whole different ballgame. And after Christ is only when salvation is open to the entire world. And therefore, choice really does become active because now it's as if everyone can have it as opposed to the Old Testament model, which when there only were a select group who were in saved relationship with the Lord and would argue that all the others stood outside of it, which of course is going to agitate a universalist who would argue, so you're telling me that God condemned 90% of the world to hell and only saved the Jews. So that's why the Old Testament model becomes much more difficult to deal with.
What if you don't believe it's both? It's just choice. Then you probably close to me, man. What's up, brother?
The Lord says to Moses, even before it happens, that I'm going to harden his heart. You know, as if to suggest this is already a done deal. When you go to Pharaoh, I know it's going to happen, and I'm going to make certain that his heart is hardened. We can debate that. I just don't want to use the term proof text. Okay. Okay, now, the reason I push the whole is will is because I know where I'm going in our next lesson. So when we get through eternal security, the next one that comes out of the soteriology and free will is the reality of hell. And there are many Christians, as you heard even in Carlton Pearson, who reject the reality of hell because where you stand on free will makes hell God's predetermined will for other people. And he had an issue with painting a portrait of God that predetermined and predestined people for eternal damnation. That's the only reason why I make jest of it like that. Okay, so let me push on just a little bit. So there's an element here you can see in salvation about whether it's choice or whether it's predetermined, correct? If we tie this into passages like Romans chapter 10, verse 8 and 9, which talks to us about salvation and how we become saved, and if you are ordained in any capacity in a Baptist church as a deacon or as a minister, you better know Romans 10, 8 and 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be what? Right, saved. For with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, and with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. And so Romans 10, 8 and 9 seems to suggest that there's something you have to do in order to receive that salvation. That there has to be a deliberate choice on your part to believe and to confess in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and therefore that is the only way one enters into salvation, which then, Michelle, does make it an issue of choice, at least to a certain degree. Now, I can't be saved if it's not God's will. I'll acknowledge that. I'm going to stand with my brother on that. I cannot be saved if it's not God's will. But one could argue that in Jesus Christ, God made salvation his will for all of humanity. Right? And so now the ownership is on you to choose whether to accept that offer or not. So just so you know, even in the hardcore free will providence argument, you know the group that stands all the way on the everything is determined by God is a group called the Calvinists. You remember we've talked about that. Calvinist theology, even Calvinists would argue the only real choice you have is to accept Christ or not. So those who stand on the hardcore extreme that everything is predetermined by God, they would argue, but the only free choice you have is whether you accept Christ or not as your Lord and Savior. That is your only free will choice. And then that allows them, Deacon Tom, to not suggest that hell is God's will, but rather your choice. Okay? So let's talk a little bit about how this then plays into eternal security. You'll see scripture to support that the decision you make to receive Christ is guided by the Holy Spirit. You don't make it in and of your own. It's God's moving of the Holy Spirit on your life. I reconcile in the same way that I do in this class that there is logical and scriptural support for both cases, and that even Paul recognizes it, because you're right, chapter 9 does seem to talk about this predestined and foreknown, but then in chapter 10, but you've got to do something. If thou shalt confess, and wherever there's if, there's a possibility of if not, right? Which implies by definition choice. And so all I'm trying to argue is that there is some degree, some element of choice in salvation, unless you stand on the hardcore extreme and want to reject it all. But there is some element of our making a decision to accept and receive. You know, and we could use 100 examples. The day I knock on the door of your heart, harden not your heart. You know, Jesus says that when I knock on the door, well, if I knock on the door, that means you got a choice to answer or not, right? So there's some element of choice in there. Here's what's the beautiful thing, and this is where we're ultimately getting to in the fall, is what do you do when you realize that there's logical and biblical evidence for two contrary opinions? Okay. That's a very critical thing Christians need to answer, because the Bible is not as easy as the Bible says so, right? Because when you really begin to study God's word, you can find logical argument for both providence and free will, right? And so how do you determine where you stand? Okay. So let's push on just a little bit. I want you to turn with me to Acts chapter 1. The question of to what degree free will plays in salvation is very critical to the discussion on eternal security. And I think you can see it very quickly. By eternal security, does everyone know what I mean? It's the once you're saved, are you always saved? Okay, we got that? So let me share with you how quickly the discussion on free will and providence plays into eternal security. Because if my salvation is predetermined and predestined by God, it of necessity must be eternally secure. Otherwise, God has made an error. Does everyone see the logic in that? If you would say that salvation is not your choice, but it is the predestined will of God for your life, then there's no way you can ever lose it, right? Because it's what God has willed, and God's will cannot be overturned. But if one would argue that it is a matter of choice, and to what degree choice plays, now my eternal security becomes unstable and can be jeopardized because my choice plays into it. And this leads to the argument of what happens to someone who makes a decision to receive Jesus Christ in their life and then strays for the rest of their life. Are they always saved? Are they always a Christian? That's the question we're trying to get to. Okay? So turn with me to Acts chapter 1. We're going to look at an example of a brother who's controversial. And I realize there are some easier examples in the Bible I could have chosen, but that wouldn't be Bible study. Acts chapter 1, beginning in, let's start in verse number 15. Acts chapter 1, verse 15. And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples. Altogether, the number of names was about 120. Peter said, "Men and brethren, this scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke before by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered with us and obtained a part in this ministry. Now this man purchased a field with the wages of iniquity, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his entrails gushed out. And it became known to all those dwelling in Jerusalem, so that the field is called in their own language, Akil Dama, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, 'Let his dwelling place be desolate, and let no one live in it, and let another take his office.' Therefore, of these men who have accompanied us of all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John to that day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." So pause. Someone tell me what's going on contextually. What is happening as Peter is speaking? What's he addressing? What about Judas? He's addressing what? Judas's death. And what has Judas's death done? It's left an opening for a need to choose another apostle. Okay, you're with me on that. Judas has died, and they cannot move on until they replace him. And what Peter says is very indicative to our conversation. He says Judas, who betrayed Jesus, had a part in this ministry. He was part of us, and now he's not. So given all that you know about Judas, here's the question that I want to lead into discussion. What do we do with Judas? How do we account for Judas? Okay. What are our options with Judas? And by that I mean, is Judas a believer who's lost his salvation? Was Judas never a believer? What do you do with Judas in this situation when we talk about eternal salvation and security? What do we do with him? Do we ever know that he really believed in Jesus Christ?
Did he just think he was a political tool and when that plan didn't work out, he didn't want to follow him anymore?
Did he really believe? It's a good question. Now, in just a few moments, when we get to the Arminian theology, the problem is going to be all the disciples were selected. Does Jesus knowingly choose an unbeliever, or does Judas fall away from a belief that qualified him at one point? Okay. Did he choose someone who wasn't in hope that he had? If so, that makes him very unique among all the other disciples. He fell away. See, look at it. It's starting already. He fell away. In John 12, yes, he does speak about, so there are those who would argue he was never truly a believer. So then you say Jesus knowingly chose an unbeliever. But we, once again, remember the picture of God that's being painted now. It's not easy to digest. All right, I'm good. And I mean, one could argue that Peter's fall is just as atrocious as Judas, right? Right. So does that mean Peter wasn't a believer? Obviously, there's no Christian tradition that would argue about Peter. You know, doctrine of Petrine succession, the whole Catholic Church, all that goes back to Peter. Right. So it's just a good question to ask, what do you do with Peter? Right. So those didn't hear arguments that Jesus forgave Judas, Judas didn't forgive himself. So, and I know you don't put people in heaven or hell. Please don't ever do that. I don't want you ever, don't ever tell folk you go to Alpha Street if you put them in heaven and hell. But is Judas in heaven or hell? My brother, yeah. Think he's in heaven? Okay, here it is. We got pop quiz. Judas in heaven, raise your hand. Judas in hell, raise your hand. Y'all are, come on, bunch of chickens. This is the safest place you can think. Okay. Yeah. Just to be certain you understand the question is, does a person who becomes a Christian eternally remain a Christian? And is it possible to lose one's salvation? Hear the relevance of it, because if there's no guarantee of salvation, if we cannot be assured that we are saved no matter what, the end result, according to most like Christian philosophers, is that humanity then has to wrestle with anxiety, because you're never sure. You know, if there's no guarantee, you're never sure. And if you're never sure, here's the real danger: you're going to try to earn it through works, because that's what's going to make you feel and give you the assurance you need. And the danger is that salvation can never be guaranteed through works. So if there's no guarantee, we got a problem. But what's the danger if you're absolutely certain that you are? What is the danger? Right, you become lax. You become apathetic to moral conduct. Okay? Because in your mind, you're convinced that no matter what I do, I'm saved. And so there's when it's pushed to the extreme, Kevin. Ken, I'm sorry, Ken. All right, we're going to talk about it. There's an extreme benefit. As a matter of fact, it's such a benefit that one of the workings of the Holy Spirit is to give you the assurance that you are saved. So that you can live out in without that fear. But then the conservative argument would be, but because of that, you would never allow yourself to simply just reach a place of immoral living. Right? Because the truly saved person appreciates and values it so much that they can't just slide into it. As a matter of fact, if you look at the weapons of warfare that the Holy Spirit gives us in Ephesians 6, one of them is the helmet of salvation, i.e. that my mind is eternally secure in knowing that I'm saved. Okay? So there's extremes, though. If there's no guarantee, I live in anxiety and works. If I have the guarantee, there's a possibility of slipping into an apathy for moral conduct. So you need to know that there are two different trains, schools of thought that argue with this, and they stand against one another. On the one hand, and it shouldn't surprise you because his name comes up whenever we deal with free will, there's the Calvinist, John Calvin. And then there's the Arminian, from the Dutch Reformer. And these two stand on opposite sides. And I want to try to share with you historically and biblically their argument. Number one, let's start with where they're in full agreement, because I think you need to see what they hold in common before you can see what they disagreed on. There were four areas of common agreement between Calvinist and Arminian thought and theology. And just know that I use these terms so that you're fully aware of the historical names, but the reality is that the way these two people thought still exists in the body of Christ today. You may not identify yourself as Calvinist, you may not even know what Arminian is, but you may share some of the same thoughts that historically were defined by these two gentlemen, right? So that's the reason I shared the terminology, so that you're aware of it. Number one, they believe, both believe, that God is powerful and keeps his promises. So that whatever the Lord has promised to the believer, whatever the Lord has said leads to salvation, whatever God's promise is, that if one loses salvation, it's not because of God. That God is powerful and God keeps God's promises. That's the very first thing they agreed upon. Number two, they both definitively agreed that salvation is not of works. That there's nothing we do to earn our salvation. They both root themselves very firmly in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. There's no disagreement. The salvation is not of works, lest any should boast, but is the free gift of God, by God's grace that we receive in faith. That's why both of these men were reformers. Are you all familiar with that term, reformers? Leaders of the Reformation. The Reformation was not just led by Martin Luther. There are many other theological voices that helped shape, and Arminian and Calvin were two of the great ones. And as you know, one of the dividing points between reformist theology and the Catholic Church was the role of works or human activity in the salvation of humanity. And the reformers absolutely rejected it, that you can't work it. You don't buy penance. You don't do Hail Marys. You don't say Our Fathers. None of that makes you saved. That you're saved by the grace of God through faith. Right? So they both agreed that salvation is not of works. Number three, they both believe that the Holy Spirit is at work in all believers. No matter how one becomes a believer, that the Holy Spirit, somebody's calling me. Who's that? Someone come on? Oh, okay, I'm joking. The Holy Spirit is at work in all believers. From the moment one decides to receive salvation or acknowledges one is saved through the working out of one's salvation, it is always the work of the Holy Spirit. That the Holy Spirit is present in every believer. Yeah. Number four, they all believed that you can have the knowledge of the possession of your salvation. You can have the knowledge of the possession of your salvation, which means that it is possible for you to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are saved. Now, let me tell you why I find that interesting, because a few Bible studies ago, a few seasons ago, I asked a question in this Bible study that was asked in the Body of Christ through a journal that did a poll and a survey of how many people know they're saved. And the reality is that less than 50% of church-going Christians identify themselves as being saved. And even when we brought it here, there are some people who didn't raise their hand. They're not comfortable in saying, I'm saved. Not comfortable in saying, I'm a born-again believer. But very comfortable saying, I'm a Christian. Very comfortable saying, I'm a member of Alfred Street Baptist Church. But am I saved? Am I a born-again believer? Which goes to show that for many people, the knowledge of salvation is still something lacking. And hopefully, after we finish this series, one of the things you will know beyond a shadow of a doubt is that you are saved. That if you've confessed in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you don't have to fear damnation. Okay? That you know you're saved. You may not be living right. Right? We're going to work on that. I'm going to go Pentecostal. You're backsliders. But you need to know that you're saved. It's a critical component. So they disagreed on that. However, I mean, that's what they agreed on, those four areas. Let's talk about where they disagree. Let's start with John Calvin. Let's start with the Calvinists. In Calvinist terminology, the Calvinists believe in this term that we've talked about before, the elect. What is meant by the term the elect? The chosen, right? That God has chosen who's going to be saved. And because of their belief in the elect, in his belief of the elect and those who agree with him, they naturally argued that there must be a permanence to salvation. Because of what I just said a few minutes ago, that if you are chosen by God, that is God's predetermined, predestined will, there's no way that can be wrong, right? There's no way you can lose it. So the elect, according to Calvinist theology, are eternally preserved. Eternally preserved. There's no way for the elect to ever lose their salvation. There's no way for them to ever reach a place where they're not a Christian. There's no way the elect can ever fall outside of a saving relationship with God. No way. They couldn't even choose it if they wanted to, because it was a decision pressed on them by the hand of an omnipotent, omniscient God who said, you are chosen, there's no other choice for your life. Let's look at a couple passages that are important to them. There's some passages, and then there's some theological arguments that support it. Let's go to 1 Peter in the back of your Bible, way towards Revelation. 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3-5. So the Calvinist argument is for eternal preservation, right? First Peter chapter 1, you there with me? Let's start in verse number 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Notice those key words: incorruptible, undefiled, does not fade away, reserved in heaven, kept by the power of God for you. So this is one of the passages that Calvinists would argue verifies that what God has for us in our salvation cannot be defiled. It cannot fade away. It cannot be taken. It is eternally secure. One that you should definitely know, Romans chapter 8. And anyone who knows Romans chapter 8 ought to know what passage I'm going to. Verse 31. Romans 8, beginning in verse 31. Romans 8, beginning in verse 31. We believe in reading Romans 5, 6, 7, and 8 at Alpha Street Baptist Church. They will ground you in your faith. You need to read Romans 5, 6, 7, and 8. You ought to memorize some stuff out of Romans 8. It's probably one of the greatest chapters in all the Bible. Romans 8, beginning verse 31. You with me? What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter, yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. They would argue that God's love is so powerful that it makes us inseparable from unity with Jesus Christ, which is how we obtain salvation. That nothing can separate us. Nothing can pull us apart. Nothing can bring a charge against us. Nothing can condemn us. Nothing can pull us outside of that, because God's love is so great that God's love can't let you go. So even Dre, if you wanted to, God won't let you break up with him. Right?
You waving a hand, hallelujah, or you got a comment? Okay, okay. Huh? So didn't Jesus love Judas? You got to bring Judas back up, huh? Yes, that Jesus even died for Judas. And as the sister over there said, and Judas chose not to accept and receive that forgiveness that was offered. That's one way to look at it. Mm-hmm. Yes, my brother. Yes, and let me tell you why that's going to be very important when we get to Arminian and try to argue it, because the Arminians are going to argue that you can lose it because of examples of those who are apostate. And we're going to come back to that in a minute, that they choose to fall outside. But what Paul argues and the Calvinists pick up on is that for every sin you commit as a sinner, Christ is still making intercession, right? So that it's still covered. So as a believer, you've got to know even if you're not living right, that there's intercession, but then again, the question is repentance a choice, right? So my sister was talking about Judas, the intercession's available if I choose to repent, that the covering is there, or do you believe that the covering is there even when I fail to repent? That if I fail to repent, does God still has mercy on me, but is my salvation affected? It got quiet in here. Folk thinking, huh? Yeah.
But so the question I have is that goes on the supposition that you were a believer in the first place.
Of course.
How do you, from a human perspective, you don't know?
Well, all right, so personally we can, but I can't tell you. Right.
No matter what you do or what I see, I don't know.
Right. So we're in theoretical area here then, right? Because we're not practicing. As I told my sister, please don't put people in heaven or hell, right? But in a practical area, the Arminians will try to argue, what was Judas's original state? Was he ever a believer? And that's what it boils down to for most Arminians. Was the person ever a true believer to begin with? Right. Right. Ken. Kid, why you gotta, just so we know, he asked, how does the fact that Satan was kicked out of heaven factor in? I mean, because it almost suggests that there's a line, like that Lucifer is an angel, you know, if we buy into that, because that it's scripturally referred to, but not, you know, taught, do we say that that was damnation that God casts out of his presence? If eternal damnation is to no longer be present with the Lord, and that's why we attach Satan and Lucifer to hell, is that the act of God? One could push it further into the Romans chapter 1 question about the reprobate mind. For those who do not want to retain the knowledge of God, that God gives them over to a reprobate mind to do that which is unseemly. You know? So does the Lord draw a line? Well, one could argue, according to this, not in Christ. That if I'm in Christ, that love makes God never say I can be cast out. Okay, tough. Okay, let's look at a few more. Maybe we'll get through the Calvinists today and pick up an Arminian. Philippians, and then we'll go to Hebrews. So we'll be going Philippians and then to the right to Hebrews. Philippians chapter 1, let's get in verse number 3. So we've got about 3 more passages to get through before we break tonight. Philippians chapter 1, verse 3. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in prayer of mine, making requests for you with all joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. Here it is, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you
will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. How does verse 6 tie into eternal security? Being confident of this very thing, he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Yes. It's a process that can't be stopped, right? And that as God is faithful and God works, that the same God who began salvation in you will complete it and continue it and complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. So it's eternally secure because the working out of your salvation is the work of God. Okay? Not simply your own shortcomings, sins, failures. It's God continuing to work it out in you. And so many of us can probably testify, you know, and I hope I can get this out right. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you know in your own self that, as Doris prayed earlier, we're a bunch of mess ups. I mean, just be honest, that you know today you messed up. If you didn't say amen, you're lying, so you got a problem right now. Right? That's your problem right now, right? Okay? Your problem is lying, okay? But here's the crazy part. As much as we mess up and as much as Satan makes us aware of our weaknesses, are you able, where you are now, to compare your life to where you were 5 years ago and know that in spite of how much you messed up, you're still growing? And it's not that you're perfect. Look, and let's be honest, it's not even that you're even really, let's just say, every day you wake up trying to be a better Christian. It's just almost inherent and instinctive that the more you worship, the more you pray, the more you stay in his word, yeah, I still mess up, but you know what? I really am progressing from where I was. And I can't take credit for it, right? He's working out what he began and will complete it in the day of Jesus Christ. So even if let me tell you how you know you're growing, because even if you know you mess up, there's some stuff you used to do that you look at it and there is nothing in you that even wants to do it again. Like, I'm done with that. I wish I would at this stage in my life. You know, oh no. I mean, there's some stuff I did in my 20s I'd be foolish to think about even trying to do at this stage in my life. Don't even have a desire to. Call my friends and hang out. Y'all want to go where? Not me. I'm saving my money. I wish I would. Hebrews chapter 7. Stay in the Bible. Get your mind right. Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 7, I want to give you a powerful promise. Now, what's crazy is that you're going to find almost all of the Arminian side comes from the book of Hebrews. They argue tremendously from Hebrews. But look at chapter 7, let's start in verse 20. Inasmuch as he, meaning Jesus, was not made priest without an oath, for they become priests without an oath, but he with an oath by him who said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not relent, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. By so much more, Jesus has become a surety of a better covenant. Also, there were many priests because they were prevented by death from continuing. But he, because he continues forever, has an unchangeable priesthood. And watch this. Therefore, he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. He is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him because he lives to make intercession. So even at our most wretched, here is where we root eternal security, that there's nothing you can do that is not covered and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. That I can never fall to a place where the intercession of Christ doesn't redeem me. and he can save me to the uttermost. I like that. I like that. Okay. Let me take a look. I'm gonna edit one out. All right, let's go quick. John. We're going to stick in the Gospel of John for just a little bit. We are still on the Calvinists. We are not going to get to Arminian until next week. For those who would argue that salvation is not secure. John 10. The Calvinists love this passage. John 10. It almost seals the deal for them. John 10, let's start in verse 25. Jesus answered them, I told you and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep, as I said to you. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Now, if I need to interpret that, we got a long way to go, right? That's almost self-explanatory from Christ, that whom the Father has called and put in my hand can never be snatched out, that they are eternally secure and eternally saved once they know my voice and they follow me. Okay. John. Well, I'm going to make reference to one. We're not going to look at this. In John chapter 15, you hear this in verses 1 through 11 about I am the vine and you are the branch. And it suggests that there's a union between the believer and Christ that is indestructible, that I and Christ have become one the same way Christ and the Father are one. And because we are one in unity, we can never be destroyed. Okay? 1 John, way in the back of the Bible. 1 John, we'll look at two passages. 1 John, right before Revelation. 1 John, chapter 3. Ooh, I was reading that, and I was like, that's not what it meant, but that's 1 Peter. Praise his name. 1 John chapter 3. Beginning in verse number 4. So now we want to talk about, well, if a believer is sinning or backslidden, how do we account for that? 1 John 3, beginning in verse number 4. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sin, and in him there is no sin. Whoever abides in him does not sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Here it is. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God. Now, before we misinterpret verse number 9, you know, that he cannot sin, it's almost suggests, well, if, man, that means I ain't saved. You know, it's not the possibility of sin. It is the continuation of sin that John is talking about. That if I am born of the Lord, if I am a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, here's the reason I know I'm eternally secure, because his seed is in me, i.e. his Holy Spirit is in me, which means according to traditional Christian language, I have been reborn, I am regenerated, right? That I am made over. And it is impossible, the Calvinists argue, for you to be unregenerated, that salvation has taken such a hold of you that it has really made you different and over. You are not who you used to be. and there's no way for that to be pulled out of you. There's no way for salvation to be extracted from your spiritual DNA. You have been regenerated. You have been reborn. You have been turned into a new creature, and you cannot revert back to the old creature you were. That sin cannot take you back to who you were before the Holy Spirit took hold of you. Once the Holy Spirit enters your life, the Calvinists, based upon 1 John, would argue that that Holy Spirit is inextricable from who you are. You can never lose the Holy Spirit, and if you can never lose the Holy Spirit, then you can never lose your salvation. 1 John chapter 5, let's go to verse 10. This is our last passage. He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God has given us his Son. And this is the testimony, that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. What John argues in the closing moment is that once you've received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you ought to know and have full assurance that you have eternal life. There may be many things you don't know about God. There may be many things about this life you don't understand. But the one thing you ought to be just certain of in your mind is that when this life is over, I rest eternally with God. That I am saved, I am born again, regardless of how you see me, regardless of what you see me doing, regardless of how I may fall and stumble. The one thing I know, and this is a personal knowledge. Hear me, this is not something someone else can confirm for you. This is not something someone else can tell you and you believe. This is what John says the believer ought to know. You ought to know every morning you wake up, you ought to thank God that you're saved. Thank God that I'm eternally secure. Thank God that my sins are forgiven. That is that helmet of salvation. That is that knowledge. That is that assurance that you let no one. Can you imagine what your life would be like if you knew every day you walked out that you couldn't fail with God? Do you know what you would do if you knew that no demon in hell could guilt you into a place of sin? Do you know how you'd walk in this life if you knew that no matter what happened to me today, if I leave out of here and that bus hit me, I ain't worried, because I'm saved. If I go out and I get struck down by a stray bullet, that's all right, because I know I'm saved. Imagine the fearless life we would live if we held on to the assurance of our salvation all the time, that I am eternally secure and safe with God. Now, I don't know what the Arminians are going to argue, but I kind of like this one. And I'm not a Calvinist. I believe in free will. So there's some incongruity in my theology. So next week, we're going to look at the Arminian side, the argument on the other side that maybe salvation is not secure because it is a result of choice. And if I can choose it, I can choose not to embrace it. Okay? And then what we're going to try to do is try to find some middle ground. From there, we go into the reality of hell and what damnation is and is not, what traditional understanding of hell is, so that we can talk about the will of God and the choice of man in regards to our eternal damnation, our eternal salvation. All right? Good, let's wrap up. We're getting out of here. It's 8 o'clock. Thank you all. Look forward, especially to our guests. I pray that you will come back and join us as we study next week.